All right, so welcome back into another Dragon Ball Supercard game video. Thank you for subscribing so far. Above here on the title screen here, you can see all the recent subscribers. Don't act like I don't see you. Thank you for doing that. I'm still trying to give away that box come August 31st if I get 5,500 subscribers or not. But you saw the title. We're going to talk about Set 14, Red Jiren. My man, I love this deck. I've been having so much fun with this deck. I think it is definitely going to be one of the decks that people are going to be trying out. Figure out how strong it is, and then other people are going to find out how to counter it, which there are counters, which I'm not really going to talk about. I'm going to wait until the meta develops and really kind of go through there. But what I am going to talk about is exploring the archetype, just like how it says, and how much I love the deck and how good it is, how strong it is. I honestly do think it is the best deck out of set 14 as far as all the other archetypes. And honestly, like, I don't really care about King Vegeta, I don't care about Blue Baby, Dark Broly, get that out of my face. You know, just try out the deck. The deck list is in the description below, and as well as the end of the video, or towards the end of the video while I talk about my deck choices or card choices. Subscribe if you're new. I'm going to be continuing the set 14 deck list and as well as the gameplay for this in a little bit, probably depending on my schedule. This will be before the gameplay. And as well as set 14 Majin Buu and U7 Gohan is probably next before that. And then a couple other archetypes like Videl. Let me know in the comments below what you want to see. So if you haven't seen the leaders already, or the leader already, basically the mechanic for Jiren is that you evolve things on their turn and you evolve things on your turn. And it does require spirit boost, which a lot of the, if not all of them for set 14, all the leaders require spirit boost, and as well as relying on the unison. And I think as you play set 14 decks, or at least things that revolve around spirit boost, you'll find out that unisons are very, very important, and the currency for markers are very important. You can't really just use them willy-nilly. And this unison, well, I'm going to talk about in a second, is no different for that. But backside says spirit boost evolve, you pay the cost as long as you minus it on their turn on their turn when they attack, and then it resolves in the auto phase. So you can gate and the auto still goes off, and you can go ahead and go through that as well. Now that I turned on the light, let's talk about the backside. the front side first. You activate main, you look at the top seven, and you play out a red universe 11 with energy cost of one in rest mode. So that can be a Jiren for evolve target, that can be any of the other one drops, which I think this deck has quite a bit of utility for the one drops, and as well as all the other universe 11 support from previous sets, and as well as the red stuff out of this, which is really good. Untap one, draw one, and basically you get to be up to 25k for your leader for the backside. When you do evolve, you can do it twice, and then same effect as far as spirit boost. Now the unison, I can see the hesitation for the unison, only because it's only a plus one. I think if it was plus two, it'd probably be close to tier zero. Like, maybe not, but definitely tier one. Like, if it was this deck would probably be tier one if this was a plus two. But technically it's a plus two as long as you have the cards. You can plus one, you play a red battle card, by the way. You don't have to play a Jiren or any of the universe 11 targets, but that's what you want to play in this deck. You play in rest mode, and then when you evolve, it gains 5k for the turn and add a marker. So what happens is that on your turn you gain gain an additional marker, and you can attack for 10k. On their turn, it's now a 10k defensively, and you get to use spirit boost, and you can get that marker right back as you use the evolve. That's basically what happens. They swing, you can negate, or you can do whatever, or if they swing into your one drops, basically, which we'll take a look in a second, you can evolve on top of that one drop. So their 10k leader swinging to now a 15k is probably neg. So, you know, that's the type of thing or the interaction that you want to see within this deck. If you're playing against this deck, which I'm not really going to talk about, like I said, any of the counters or anything like that, because I wanted the meta to develop, and I am not the person to talk about that, especially since there's no events just yet. But when they do, people will start doing that or attacking the unison first. Anyway, moving on to the one drop. So before we look at the Zoroark, the two one drop Jirens, one draws you a card and the other one looks at the top five for a red Jiren card or a red unison with specified cost of one. So it's going to be your topo or really any other one drop unison, which I don't think we have many. We think we have the King Piccolo, and that's pretty much it. But the other thing is that you use the evolve cost to be three for energy cost of four. So you can play the other Jirens if you really want to. I don't think that's the way, You can if you want to, but I don't think that's the way. You can even play the old Jiren that really people really loved, the dual attack one. Love that card back in the day. Set three, four. And another one drop Jiren is that one is in the drop, which means when you're they're swinging into your one drop, you can evolve on top of another one drop or something else, or do whatever you want, and then let this thing die, because now, oh, or you can topo and pitch it, or you can violent rays and pitch it, and now you can actually use the effect in which you pitch a card, which is pretty important for the one drops using Pride of Universe 11 to play him out. And then you can discard a card, put this in the bottom of the deck, and then pick a five or less evolve. So there's going to be some plays where you're going to be, again, topoing, you're going to be violating, like I said, you're going to be comboing out, you're going to be, okay, go ahead and attack that, I'll evolve on something else. Those type of things is going to be really important. Now, the Kunchi protects these two, in which if it's in active mode or even in rest mode, it doesn't really matter. Now they can't really target it to put in rest against yellow. They can't really target it against Shocking Death Ball or Dormant Potential, things like that. That's why Kunchi not only replaces the card that, or I should say replaces itself, but also on the leader effect, you're effectively drawing two, which you're taking one life and you're drawing a card if you look at the top seven with this card, which is, I think Kunchi is really important because Zore on the left side is basically a barrier blocker with him and it can't be KO'd once per turn. It's one of the best plays that you can do. You can have Kunchi on the field and then Zore on the field as well. And if you have like two Zores, that's basically two to three attacks because they're going to be swinging into the Zores when you block them and going to swing into it again in order to kill them. And then you're like, okay, that's fine. I'll combo these or I'll let them die. In which I just realized that I was blocking it. So sorry, you can look at it now. Pride of Universe 7 or Universe 11, where you can play out 2-1 drops. So what happens again is that you can combo out these guys. You can let them die. You can block them. You can do whatever you want. And then you can use Pride of Universe 11 to either play Kunchi on your turn and then Zora to get a barrier blocker. And then they can't target any of your other Jirens as well. Or you can play out 2 Jirens and now you have 2 evolved targets, which these guys don't have any skills, but that doesn't matter because now when you evolve on top of it, it's a brand new card. You can still get the skills and you still get all the effects. If I'm wrong on that, let me know, but I'm pretty sure that's how it is because it's a brand new card. What I do know is that power does transfer over, but not skills. So it's probably the same thing. I've been just having so much fun with just all the interactions with the one drops. There are other one drops, yes. There are other Universe 11 cards, yes. That's fine. I literally don't care. The ones that are in my deck list, I play them. There you go. All right, let's talk about the evolved targets. Now, we have the two rares on the left, the promo, and then as well as the super rare. Now, the super rare is crazy, but the two rares here, what happens, I love the four drop Devastating Might because now you have a free evolve that draws you one, replaces itself, and then you can neg 10k on their turn. You can only do it once for that turn, and as well as on their turn, which you're only doing once with Spirit Boost anyway. But scratch that. I forgot that Spirit Boost, if we go back into the Spirit Boost or the auto, it can proc off as many times as they swing, and it's proc off as many times as you have markers. So just keep that in mind. I think it's just busted. Anyway, moving on. So the 4-drop Jiren becomes a 15k, replaces itself negative 10k. So on your turn, you can gain a marker, you can get a 15k swing, you can look at the top seven, take a card from life, replace itself after you draw one from the 1-drop. And then on the 5-drop, you can evolve on their turn, paying that 1 energy, like on turn 2. You give your leader a 10k boost or 1000k boost, really, draw you a card, and then it doesn't get removed. And you can take a life and help yourself awaken, which is usually what you want to do. Or you can place the 2 cards in the owner's drop. So this is protected when it gives you a dual attacking 19k on your turn when it goes back to you, and as well as a Sensu Bean for 1000. This guy can also prevent a swing onto your 1-drop or your Unison or whatever, because now if they're swinging with the 15k, and then you evolve, you minus it for 10k. Now it's a 5k to your 10k Unison. Now they have to combo something out, or they just forget it altogether. So, I mean, these guys just do work. I love it so much. The Unseen Potential is really good to kind of fix your hand Looks at the top seven for a free evolve cost for one. Also, by the way, this guy evolves on one and a four, which is just nuts. I wish they just did it four, because it's just super strong that way. Otherwise, but you can just get a dual attacker for free or for one after you play something for free. It's just nuts, because you can use Universe 11 or Private Universe 11 and then evolve on top of the one drop, and now you have a draw one. Can't be removed from your battle area as long as you have the permanent in effect, and dual attacking 19k. What was interesting in testing, by the way, someone tried to steal the heroine or with heroine's lineage in the combo step, and because of the permanent, I can just take a life and say no, and you can just go all in. And now they wasted their energy, and now they wasted that whole thing because it's saying when it leaves the battle area. So if I'm wrong on that, hilarious. Well, not hilarious, but hilarious otherwise. Anyway, this guy fixes your hand, looking in the top seven for a red Universe 11 card. It can be a Jiren target. It can be this guy, which is usually what I get, because I don't think any of the other cards really search for it. Or you can look at the one drop. So really, really good. You have to place a bottom card or one card from your deck or your hand to the bottom of the deck. But this guy can evolve on top, or with this guy on top of this guy. So this guy can be evolved with a four or five. And the fact that you can do this on three or more energy for two is just nuts, man. I can't express this, man. So here's the thing. Basically, every time that you evolve, or any time that you think about evolving for any of these cards, especially this eight drop Jiren, is that it creates a whole thing of utility for the deck. And what I mean by that is that on offense on turn three, which is usually what, if you're on the play and you got a bunch of your Jirens, which it's just gonna happen as you play the deck, you go into this guy where you can remove another battle card with 35k or more, and then you plus a marker on your unison. If you're awakened, you gain 5k, and then you swing with a double striking 35k on turn three for two energy. And then if they negate it, okay, that's dope. You place one of the three cards, usually, because it's the one drop, the four drop, and the five drop, underneath it, and you switch it to active mode, and your leader now is a 5K, and now you're swinging again for 35K double strike, which is why Champa, Frieza Death Ball, all these other cards that boost your leader and as well as these other cards are super important in my opinion. Just a super strong card, because now that's the offense. The defense is that as long as you have two energy, three or more energy, you can keep that bad boy there. If you know that they have some sort of big boss or something that is 35k or less, you're gonna have to keep this one. And now they have to deal with the 35k barrier, an ignoring barrier type of card. The only downside is that it doesn't have deflect and it doesn't have barrier. So whoop-de-doo. Whatever. All right, so here are all the other targets, or all the other Universe 11 cards out of set 14 from that I know of. So I could probably talk about the evolve Jirens all day if I really wanted to. But the first one is more of a sidebar card. It's really for Mechiavora, since Reboot Gohan is not really a thing anymore. It just means that they can't attack with their leader for the racing in a turn. Vaughn is cool because now you can play it out, draw one card, it replaces itself just like everything in the deck. And then all your Universe 11 cards gain 5k for the turn. So, which is nice, because if you're trying to take game turn four, you can boost all your Jirens, you can boost your leader, you can boost now a 40k double striking dual attacker as well. So if that's on the field, don't play it against blue. That's all it is. And then Carousel, which is deflect blocker. So it's a two cost. And if it wins a remove from the battle area by opponent's skill, you can remove, or you can take a life instead. If your leader card is a red Universe 11 card, you can choose up to two of your red Universe 11 cards with energy cost of one and 10k power or less in your battle area and switch to red active mode. I don't think this is really worth playing. I could be wrong. I haven't really tested it too much, but is what it is. Tupper is cool. I actually do like him at a three. I think you're playing better things at three or doing more things at three, but I think this is more of a sidebar card where dual attack, barrier, and as well as negging two things for 15k. That's actually pretty good. Like I actually really do like this card, because the time that you do play it, not only that you're removing two threats if they're 15k, but also the fact that they have to swing into a 20k, which is generally not the best thing outside of Dark Broly to do. You're getting a dual attack barrier card every turn, or 20k dual attack every turn. I mean, that's pretty good. If I found room for anything in this, it would probably be Tupper and as well as Source of Power. But the Kettle is a Denial Hope, basically, for two, as long as you have Bond 3. So anything 20k or less, it gets played in the drop area instead, and you play this card. I think it's searchable by the promo, so that's pretty good as well. So it's pretty niche, I think, for a lot of different things. Again, more of a sidebar card. It is a nice 2k or 2 cost 15k blocker that is a Denial of Hope. And then you get to minus something 10k. This guy does a lot. So again, another thing to consider. I just don't play it. Source of Power is actually really cool because the counter step for Source of Power resolves before the auto. So basically what it says is that you negate the attack for one, which is good. A lot of these cards don't negate attacks anymore. But to negate the attack, you get a 5 drop or a 5 or less Jiren card with his evolve skill from your deck and add it to your hand, shuffle, and then you get to play a Universe 11 card, and you cost 1 with skills negated in rest mode on their turn. So it's because it's their turn, it's kind of whack, but if they swing again, or I think if they do swing, you still resolve it, so you can get the evolve target and then evolve on top. Mistake, if I'm wrong or mistaken, let me know, but pretty cool card. Definitely would consider it. It's just that the deck itself is super big and huge. And here's the deck. So a bit awkward. DBS Deck Planet is still down at the time of this recording. It's probably gonna be up by the time this is out, or maybe later in the week. But this is the untapped deck that I've been playing. If you want, you can download it in the description below and try it out yourself. As far as the choices, 4 of the Devastating Might is pretty much optimal. I don't think you shouldn't play any of the evolved Jirens of 4, not at 4, if I was mistaken. What am I even saying? Play all the Jirens at 4 except for the promo, which is the 3. So there you go. The reason for that is because you want to see evolved targets. You want to see the 1 drop Jirens. So there you go. And everything that you do play should replace itself. So you're filtering through the deck pretty quickly. To the Pride of the Universe 11, you can probably play 3, but when I did, I saw it too much. Probably is an untapped thing, if anything. To the Frieza Death Ball, really, really good for closing out the game, especially when you're swinging with the 20k, 25k leader, or the 35k Zenith, or the 19k, I can't be removed anyway, Jiren 5 drop. The Yamcha Merciless Barrage is just a staple in red at this point when you're playing it a unison. And we have 2 King Piccolo, the new ruler. You can probably play this at 3, but I think it's pretty hard to keep 3 or more markers nowadays, especially with spirit boost. So let me know what you think, apparently. And then and Saiyan Youth, it's just the best super combo. I don't think you play any other super combo in this deck. Everything is red and it's good. There you go. And then Supreme Kind of Time, you can probably play the new Universe 7, the new Universe 7 secret, but you're waiting until turn 5 and it can be answered pretty quickly. So no, thank you. This is a lot better. Topo Force Obliteration, that's the unison 2 topo as far as the negate, 2 negates as far as Violent Rays. Both of those should be pretty much staples in red at this point. I'm not going to explain it. And then 3 of the Topsy Turvy. So I think where you can consider is the Universe 11 cards that I talked about before. You can consider Overrealm, but just remember that you're going to be messing up the 1 drop Jiren plays. Pretty much the only thing, honestly, and as well as the Pride of the Universe 11, which is why I don't play Overrun in this. Maybe another new ruler, and then instead of 2 of the Frieza Death Ball, you can probably play 2 unisons. So maybe the 3 drop unison, or you can play 2 of the Piccolo Descent. Most likely, if this deck becomes meta or within the format, people are just gonna do 4 of the Piccolo unison, realize that 1 draw is not that much worth when you're not setting up all your plays for the evolved targets, which if you're not playing the evolved targets, or if you're not doing it, then you're probably not playing the best Jiren deck, honestly. That's just my opinion. Let me know what you think in the description. Wow, in the comments below. I am just messing up today. It's been a long day, honestly, but I will see you in the next one.